is on continuous data, okay? So I prepared some slides on it, but not everything. But I also, but I still included some possible code for you to use. What we're gonna do today is maybe go over some of this and then see what you think that you're doing, okay? So the continuous example, so again, we're still talking about identification disclosure risk. So okay, and we're still talking about the three summaries that we've been talking about, the expected match risk, the true match rate, and the false match rate. And but the thing is, with continuous data, as you can see, it might get a little bit more challenging. So in the go over what we actually need in computing all of this. So first of all, it's CI. That's the number of records with the highest match probability for the target record I. And in practice, what we do will just be the subset of all of the records sharing the same null information by the intruder. Okay? For categorical variables, we have looked at it before, that we will just consider all records in the same known pattern. But for continuous variables, again, if you are matching exactly, might not be open. I just saw. All right. And then for continuous variable, the challenge here more is about if you are matching exact values, like say, if you're looking at income and some consumer unit's income is 10,531.5 cents, something along the lines. If you're matching that detail values, it's just gonna be zero. Right? I mean, it's very unlikely that you're going to have somebody exactly at that value, but that doesn't mean that there's no risk. So that's why earlier, when we're covering those definitions and those quantities, I gave the suggestion that we consider all records within a certain distance from the record based on that continuous variable. Okay, so categorical variable, you can match exactly at the category level. But then for continuous, we might have to be a little bit creative and all that. So we're gonna talk about that as well. And then everything else stays pretty much the same, right? We have the TI, if the true matches among the CI units, and TI will be one, TI will be zero otherwise. And we're still gonna have this KI, FI, N, and S. Okay, so KI earlier, we went through it really quickly, but the definition, as you can see, is KI equals to one if CI times TI is one. So the only possibility for CI times TI to be one is CI is one and TI is one, okay? TI is one meaning that it is among the matches and CI equals to one is it's a unique match, okay? Only these two multiplies together equals to one, KI equals to one. And that's why we can declare a true match, a true unique match, I should say. Fi here is Ci times one minus Ti equals to one. Okay, so again, for that quantity to be one, Ci has to be one and Ti has to be zero. So it's gonna be a unique match, but it's actually not the true match. So that's when we define Fi equals to one. Fi equals to zero otherwise, okay? Capital N is the total number of target records. Typically, capital N equals to little n is the number of records in the sample because we evaluate the risk for every record. And small s is the number of uniquely matched records. So that is the case. Again, I should have put an extra parenthesis here, I think, because otherwise this is a little confusing. Just looking at how many of the CI equals to one. Okay. But CI equals to one, meaning that it's a unique match, or for that record, it's only a unique match. So we're counting how many there are. And then finally, we have the expected match risk. It's on average how likely it is to find the correct match for each record. Okay. So that's a sum of the ratio TI over CI. True match and false match rate, both of them are percentages. Okay. The first one is a percentage of unique matches, and then the other one is the unique matches to be false matches. Okay. So KI over N, sum over, and then FI over S, sum over. So this is what we have known so far, and then we have to focus on that. So this page is actually blank. What I'm hoping is to hear from what you have been doing, or if you have got the chance to do it, share what you have done. Or if you haven't got the chance to do much about it yet, but at least we can talk about what you would be doing if you were to do this. So let me see. Yeah, I might have to. Yeah, let me just stop sharing here so we come back and then we can. Maybe okay. Yeah, Sarah, I saw your hand. Just give me a second. So maybe we can just like chat within the small groups again before we come back. Recording and hear from some of you. I sort of like joined each room a little bit to hear your thoughts. So there are some common, I think, ideas. Sarah, if you want to start, because you were raising your hand earlier, feel free to get us started.
Oh, sorry. I had like just a clarifying question that got resolved in my meeting. So, my one idea was whether it would be better for something that would like something like the income that we generally top coat to make like instead of making like one constant I called it omega, but like like variable looking back and forth that you're kind of discretizing by, but like if it would be helpful to make that variable like depending on like kind of the normal distances between like data points that we have in this set, and if that would like be a better measure. I didn't end up having time to write that up, but was my one.
Yeah, so I think Sarah's idea is that instead of exactly matching, because we know that for a continuous variable, exact matching probably doesn't make sense. Maybe we can create like an interval, right, around the true value, and then whatever like records falls into that true value, that particular interval, we'll declare that as a match, right? I think that's what you're...
Yeah, but my question was, would it be better to have the interval be variable depending on the data itself?
Yeah, that's a great point. Yeah, so I can let Reese to jump in because I think he had that idea as well. So what Sarah was trying to say is that, like, say for every consumer unit, maybe instead of using like $500 as the interval for every record, we can probably use some kind of like percentage, like say, like, I don't know, like 10% or 20% of the actual value. So we are being a little bit more flexible because $500 means differently for each consumer unit's income, right? I mean, for really high income consumer unit, maybe 500 is too small as a like a interval to consider. Whereas for low income consumer unit, 500 might be sufficient. So using a percentage, I'm gonna call it radius in my slides coming up, but using a percentage radius instead of like an actual value radius might be more reasonable. Depends on the situation. Yeah, so Reese, do you want to jump in?
Yeah, sure. So like what I did was, so like for the log income, I just used the same method you used for the categorical synthesized analysis. But instead of having a unique match, I have a range that is like acceptable for like to be recognized as a successful match for the data intruder. I use like 0.1 for the log income. So if the synthesized data is within 0.1 of the original data, I consider it to be a successful match. And I basically just repeat the process for categorical data and model the function a little bit to do the synthesized for the continuous data.
Yeah, sounds good. So I think the 0.1, I guess you're talking about on the log scale. So I guess you're using a fixed value for every consumer unit, log income. Right?
I'm sorry, I didn't get that.
Oh, yeah. So the 0.1, I guess you're talking about like, say, for every log income of the consumer unit, it will just be like minus, like negative 0.1 and positive 0.1 in that range.
Yeah, right. It will be in a 0.1 radius. Yeah.
Yeah, sounds good. So that, I guess, is, again, using the fixed value. So you can, like what I was saying earlier, y'all can, if you want to be flexible and reflect the actual value of the log income in the data, then you can use a percentage instead of using a fixed value. Any other comments? Kevin?
Yes, I did something similar, but I also was comparing like using that like fixed point across the individual entries, but looking at how like similar they are across both the original and the synthetic and seeing like if anything changed, like if it was clustered in the original, then like spread out in the synthetic, or like spread out in the synthetic and spread out in the original and stuff like that. And just seeing like maybe which one indicates like a more successful synthesis or like a more risk of disclosure.
Yeah, so that's a good point. And so that clustering idea and also I think the measures that we talked about, we mentioned them mostly in the, utility evaluation, right? I mean, like as a way to, as somebody else to differentiate between the two, and then the harder it is for someone to differentiate the two, the higher the utility. And you can also think of this, like what Kevin was saying is that you can also think of this from the angle of the disclosure risk. Right, and I think Isaac at some point, I don't remember the context, but also talking about like the how close these two ideas are, in a sense that the utility measure and the risk measure, and then you can actually devise them, I mean, one way or another, but we just need to make sure that we define it clearly and then do that. But one caveat I would say, Kevin, I don't know exactly what you did, but one caveat I want to mention, which will be related to what we're gonna talk about next time as well, is when we're thinking about a risk, we probably have to be very careful thinking about whether it is an identification risk or it is a disclosure risk. Whether it's an identification risk or it's an attribute risk. So identification risk, what we're talking about now, I mean today, and then the class before the break was for thinking about identifying somebody's identity, right? And that is where we assume that we know the true value of the synthetic value. And then we only know, like, we only gonna match based on the known variable, right? But then there are other cases where once you do synthetic data set, like for this consumer expenditure survey, let's just say the income is synthesized. Maybe I don't just want to know who is who. I might want to know exactly for this particular consumer unit, how large or what is exactly the log income is. So when we're attempting that kind of thing, that will be an attribute exposure. So a lot of times it's very easy to get confused about which one you're trying to get. And so again, Kevin, I don't know exactly what you did or what you're trying to get, but when you're thinking about like the distance or like how big the difference is between the two, it might as well be a attribute disclosure instead of a identification disclosure. But you can always like turn it around to the other one. So just be careful when we're doing all of this.
Okay.
Any questions, comments, other things?
Just to clarify, so if we're looking at identification disclosure risk, then is log income the known variable then?
Great point. What do you all think? So Maggie's question is, now we have... if we're trying to do identification disclosure for a continuous variable, okay, log income, do we assume that we know it or we don't know it? This is getting into like the actually doing it, and it's not a easy question to answer actually. So let me repeat the question and maybe I will just do the breakout rooms really quick before we come in. So the question is, now we're trying to figure out the identification disclosure risk for this consumer unit, consumer expenditure survey data, where we have synthesized the log income. Okay? So now with the particular CU, let's just say this particular CU, I'm trying to identify this CU. Should we assume that we actually know the true value of the synthesized log income, or we should not in practice? Okay? So you can maybe relate back to what we did before. For the categorical data, what we did, you can pull up the slides and see. I think we assume three known variables, right? And then I think none of the known variables are actually synthesized in that example, okay, for the categorical, okay? So just to be clear. But for continuous variables, what do you think we should be doing? And I'm gonna just do the breakout room again. All right, what do you think? Should we assume that the synthesized, yeah, like how can we make the assumption of what the intruder knows in this case? Anyone? Okay, maybe you can just raise your hand. Do you think we should assume that the intruder knows it? Yes? They should know it? Or no? Okay, so Kevin and Henrik says no. Everybody else? So Sarah cannot hear us. Let me see. Good. So what we can do is, right, so just, so I think Kevin and Henrik think we shouldn't assume it. Maggie, what do you think now? You asked the question in the first place.
I found on your lecture slide about like identification disclosure, and it said is to find out the identity of the person an intruder is looking for. So I think if they probably should know their income because they're looking for a specific mm-hmm. person mm-hmm. and you're calculating the identification disclosure risk for income.
Mm-hmm.
So, but then if we're like using like your codes to calculate the risk, then the known variable and the synthesized variable are the same. So I
right in the okay yeah maybe this is a good time for me to just get the slides up and like I was saying for the categorical case the examples that we saw they are not the same, right? I mean the known variables and the so actually I have it here I think so remember this example in the ACS example, yes. Mm-hmm. So this was the one that we went over earlier today, that the four variables are synthesized, language, place of birth, disability, and health insurance coverage. And the known variables are this, the other three, okay? There are nine variables in total. So we actually, the particular exercise that we did are the case that they're not the same. Actually not overlap at all, okay? But that doesn't mean that you cannot have them to be the same, okay? So in practice, let's see. So in practice, I think the code, this code might not be that helpful just because it's too long to go over. But if we focus the match K here, maybe let's focus on it. Actually, what I can do, just give me a second. Actually, I put it together there. But let me just, the categorical case, this is what we did, right? So the seen variables and the known variables, they are mutually exclusive, right? None of them are overlapping with one another in this sample code here. So I guess the question is, I mean, doing it is one thing, but then thinking about it logically, I guess, is another, because what Maggie pointed out was, well, if I'm trying to find the identity of somebody, like say the income, in this case, there is no income for the ACS, but for CE, let's just say, we know the income, we want, okay, whether we know or not, we don't know yet, but we have synthesized the income, okay? So let's just say the CE data set only has, I think, let's just see, let me just write it. So the CE data, the simplest case that we looked at before has four variables, I think. Okay, so it's income, expenditure, race of the reference person, and then the urban-rural status, I think. Okay. So continuous, categorical, and then binary. Okay, so these are the four variables here. So the simplest case that we looked at was synthesize this. Okay, so that means in your synthetic data, let's just think about one synthetic data for now. Okay, we have synthesized income, okay, expenditure, not synthesized, race, not synthesized, and then urban rural status, not synthesized either. So now we know this is synthesized, okay? So what will be the most sensible way to think about the identification disclosure here? Meaning that, well, this is the symbols, right? That's the only ones. If we're gonna code it, this will be the only one going to here. But how can we do the known variables? I think that's the main question. Whether we should assume that the synth income is actually the true value, I should say, the true value of the synth income is actually known to the intruder or not. Okay. What do y'all think now? I have to do this. Yeah, I can see now. So anybody wants to share anything? I mean, this is, again, I think this is a great question because this is thinking about in practice what you're actually gonna do. And the coding will be related to this. So when we go into the synthetic data, I know my neighbor's information. Maybe I know all of them, the income, expenditure, race, and urban rural status, right? I can use all of them to find the person in the data set. But let's just say we assume that the known variables do not include income yet. So what does that mean? Let's just say the known variables are the three here. If we do that, in practice, what do we mean? If it's the three variables here that assume to be known to the intruder, the intruder does not know the true value of the synthesized income for this record. Can we still carry out the computation? Or maybe we're stuck. I guess we can, right? We can look at, so in practice, what we do, we still have that CI over TI, TI over CI, right? If we want to do this, right? For the expected match. So TI, well, will be binary. We're going to figure out what to do. But then for the CI, what is CI? CI will be all of the records in the synthetic data that are sharing the same known information as the record that I know about, right? So if I have this record at hand, I know it's expenditure, I know it's race, I know it's urban rural status. And then I go into the synthetic data and then count how many there are, right? That's pretty much like, first of all, what I would do with my CI. I'm gonna count how many there are. So the question is, can we do that? And then on the other hand, if the synthesized income is also one of the known variables, I guess in practice, we can still do the computation, right? But I guess just which one is more realistic as the assumption of what the intruder should know. What do you all think? I've been talking for a while, so happy to hear from what you think. Again, I mean, this is open-ended. I think you can go either way. And it might be very context specific. In the work that I did before, I mostly actually assumed that the synthesized income, for example, in this case, will actually be known to the intruder, because otherwise, why would I be interested in finding this person's identity? But I think it can easily be argued the other way around that, well, I just don't know the income, but I still know about this records expenditure rates and urban-rural area, urban-rural status. And in the released synthetic data sets, I still want to, I mean, try my best to figure out whether like which one or which ones might be the record that I'm trying to find out. So one thing we can think about all of this is that the known variables, let's just say, in one scenario, let's just say we know two of them among the four. And in the other scenario, let's just say we assume we know three of them. So moving from two to three, the number of known variables, naturally the value of CI is gonna drop, okay? Because CI is the number of records that are gonna share the exact same known information as the record that you're working with, okay? If you're only matching with two variables, then let's just say maybe you have 10 records that are sharing the same information based on the two variables, right? And now I'm knowing one more. So naturally, only gonna, like, there will only be a subset of that 10 records gonna have the same information on the three variables. Right? So the more variables you know, or the more variables are assumed to be known by the intruder, there will be an effect on CI. And the effect actually just gonna be, the more known variables there are, the lower the CI value will be. Because you're like getting a smaller subset, smaller and smaller. So that will be something good to keep in mind. But in practice, like whether you want to assume that the synthesized variable is actually the true value of the synthesized variable, whether it's known to the intruder or not, I think it's actually open-ended. But of course, based on your assumption, you will have to determine how you want to write your code. All right, so hopefully that solves some of the concerns or questions. And let me just come back to the slides really quick so we can wrap this up. So this is what we did before for the categorical case. And I included some coding techniques. It looks long, I have to break so many lines just because I want to keep everything in the same page. But let's just say I was talking about a one univariate continuous variable. Let's just say the sing vowels will be only the income variable in the consumer expenditure. And I define this radius. Okay, so you see this radius here. You see, sorry. Yeah, my other class is talking on Slack. So you see this radius here, okay? So radius is similar to what we were talking about earlier, like thinking about the distance from the true value of the synthesized univariate continuous variable. Okay, so income, you can either do $500 for every CU or a percentage for every CU. Okay, so that means if I have like a 10,000 households, 10,000 income household, then 20% will be 2,000. Okay? Whereas if I have a 20,000 household, then 20% will be 4,000. Okay? So this is same percentage, but then applying to different CU with different income base in the first place, then the radius is gonna be elastic in some way. Okay, it is changing according to how much the CU is making in the first place. So this could be argued that it's more flexible because again, $500 means different for the two different CUs here, okay? But you can also just do 500 for all of them if you think that's more reasonable. But regardless, we have this radius quantity here, and you can see that in the code. Okay, so the code actually works very similar as before. So we first of all match all of the known variables. Okay, so that is again auric data and then syn data k because we're doing multiple of them. And then for a continuous variable, instead of doing exact matching, so this is exact matching, right? Equal equal, so it's checking exactly the same. But then for a continuous variable, say a scene vowels, let's just say it's gonna be income, so it's univariate, only one of them here. So what we're doing here is we're like looking at the interval, right? We're looking at the interval of the synthetic data. The income of the synthetic data is actually lower than the income of the original data plus that radius, okay? And also it's greater than the original true income minus the radius. Okay, so we are doing, so let's just say this is true value, okay? We're bracketing it, creating a bracket here of the radius from true value minus the radius to true value plus the radius. Okay. And we're doing this for every record, okay? So you actually have to define radius for observation I. So you know that in the loop, you'll be able to do that. But pretty much what we're doing is that, first of all, we're looking at how many records are sharing the same known vowels, okay? And then within them, we're further checking for the synthesized variable. We're looking at this bracket, right? We're looking at how many records actually fall into this interval. It is the true value minus the radius to the true value plus the radius. And then that will overall give you the count of how many observations are determined to be a match. And then that in the end can give you the CI. One other thing I want to mention, especially since Maggie asked the question earlier, that the way that I'm writing this, you can see that, well, I'm writing it in a way that the seen vowels actually are not known, right? But you could make that known. The way that I'm writing it is just making the assumption, or like the way, I should say, the way that I'm writing it is sort of saying that the seen vowels is not known to the intruder, so you can do it this way. If the seen vowel is known to the intruder, you can sort of like put this two together. But of course, if the seen vowels is continuous, you have to create a bracket in this way as well. So I hope that overall makes sense to you. But again, I think once you're working on your project, when you get into the details of all of this, some of the questions probably will be solved. But of course, always happy to chat. Doing office hours or doing appointments, just to see that you're making the progress and then clarify any of the questions you have. Right. The last part, I just have one discussion question for you all is, we talked about one synthesized continuous variable, univariate, right? So we can create an interval. But what if you have more than one? Okay. If you have more than one synthesized continuous variables and then you're trying to create a way to match all of them at the same time, what would be a reasonable way to move forward? I'm gonna put the question up here and then do the breakout room. I'm gonna do a new one this time since we are moving to a new discussion. And I'll have to do it again because I was assigned with only one person. When you're creating that kind of interval, it's not only for the seen vowel. I mean, this is the demo that you only have one synthetic variable, which is continuous. But if you have any continuous known variables, you also have to worry about how you're going to create that interval. And then if you have more than one, you have to think about how to do it for more than one. Okay, so the question actually should be expanded to not only just synthesize continuous variables, but if you have more than one, any continuous variables in the setup, what can you do? Okay, so anyone wants to share the thoughts? Feel free to speak up. Anyone? Or any questions?
Our group talked about standardizing the synthesized continuous variables or also I guess also using like the percent to create the corresponding radius.
So you do that for, I guess, every variable and then do it one by one.
Yeah, that's one. I think that's one way we could do it.
Sounds good, Sarah.
Well, my group was thinking you just had like different radii. If you had different radii, you would check. If to calculate CI, you would check both radii for those both continuous variables, and if they mm-hmm. both matched, you would count it mm-hmm. in the CI there.
Yeah,
I think that, that was our way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that will be. So you're, yeah, so that will be the way to think about each of them univariately and then think about like the distance, right? So definitely, and you can also think about other distance metrics, like say if you want to think about like if it's, because what we're doing is one dimension, right? Like thinking about them separately and then just check if they fall into the interval every time. But you can also, I guess, create distance based on two variables at the same time. And then like you can do like distance, let's just say the univariate distance from one and two, so x and y, and then you do this x squared plus y squared and then take the square root of that. And then that might be another way to think about the distance. So it's open-ended. The tricky part, I never did the research in this in that idea, but I can easily imagine that if you have too many continuous variables, if you start to like create that radii or radii for so many different variables at the same time. I mean, if you have more than 5 or 6 or 7, maybe you're gonna have no records fall into them at the same time, right? Just because you have so many and you're checking. So that might be challenging. So that might be something good to think about when you're doing your project. And if you run into that, I mean, it's natural, you might just have to readjust what you are trying to do. Anything else before we go to hearing from your projects, any questions or discussions? Okay, all right, I will take that as a no.